Hi, everybody, and welcome to your first lecture on Chapter 1 of Voet and Pratt in Biochemistry. So this is BSc CH308 course. So in this first lecture, we're going to go over basically the functional groups that you're going to find in a lot of these biopolymers, such as DNA and proteins. We'll also talk about the components of the cell. This is important because, you know, different compartments in the cell are where different metabolic reactions take place. And then we'll also talk about thermodynamics, which is basically, you know, the driving force of all of these metabolic reactions going on in the body. So basically, this is kind of a review for a number of y'all. You know, you got a lot about functional groups and organic and gen chem, as well as some of the thermodynamics. And then anybody of y'all who's taken biology already, you should have a good understanding of the components of the cell, the differences between prokaryotes and eukaryotes. But I just wanted to make sure, you know, we're on the same page. So that's why we're kind of going over this today. So here we have the Chapter 1 objective that I feel that y'all should be able to complete after, you know, going through the material and our group activities in class. I'm not going to read over these objectives. This presentation, the PowerPoint slides themselves are in the Moodle, so feel free to go download it and print out this slide and go through it. You know, I do recommend reading over the objectives and maybe, you know, writing it out, making sure that you can meet these objectives. So, you know, when we're talking about biochemistry, basically we're talking about organic molecules, and organic molecules consist primarily of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, as you can see here. And, you know, all living matter is the majority carbon, as well as nitrogen, oxygen, and hydrogen that I said. And so, you know, this table just gives you a good indication of, you know, how these elements make up all the proteins, DNA, organelles, cells, tissues, and then organisms that make up, you know, life. And it's really cool that it's just these elements, but yet how they're connected, how they're covalently bound together in certain patterns that make up functional groups. And it's these functional groups and the way they interact with each other that drives the properties of molecules to fold in the way that they need to fold, say for proteins or DNA, as well as allow, you know, enzymes to function the way they do. You know, without, you know, these functional groups made up of these elements bound in certain patterns, you wouldn't get these properties. So for instance, a lot of biopolymers are made up of condensation reactions where water is removed, say between this carboxylic acid and this amino group, where they come together and then undergo condensation, removing water to form now what was two molecules into one molecule, or a polymerization that we see occurring, you know, over and over again when, you know, we are translating RNA in order to make protein, and we're linking amino acids together. There's also enzymes that can come in and hydrolyze, you know, cause these molecules to undergo hydrolysis. So breaking up the polymer into two different molecules by adding water across the bond. And we'll get more into these mechanisms and these reactions, but just kind of keep that in mind. You know, the basic reactions that you learned about in organic chemistry, we're going to see over and over again when we talk about enzyme mechanisms and these enzyme mechanisms that drive metabolism that allows us to, you know, convert energy into matter in order to grow, or break down matter to create energy in us, you know, for us to walk or breathe. Let's see. So, you know, here what we're looking at is the complementary molecules associate. So, again, because of functional groups, in this case we're looking at the polarity interaction between an amino group and a carboxylic group that brings these two macromolecules together through, you know, electronegative interactions or polar interactions, that will bring these molecules together to interact. And this may drive folding. It may drive hybridization. Say with two different strands of DNA, you get hybridization between base pairing, making hydrogen bonds. Or let's say you have a protein that's folding into a three-dimensional structure. A lot of that is driven by, as we can see here, hydrogen bonding between the hydrogen that's bound to the electronegative nitrogen that can then interact with the negative oxygen on the carboxylic group. So just keep that in mind. You know, this is why functional groups and knowing your functional groups and understanding the property of your functional groups is so important. But I will tell you, a lot of it has to do with electronegativity and hydrogen bonding, as well as van der Waal interactions. So here we see just a huge list array of functional groups. So we've got amines, alcohols, thiols, ethers, aldehydes, ketones, carboxylic acids, esters, thioesters, amides, amines, so on and so forth. I'm going to have to, you know, be honest with you, you're probably just going to have to commit these to memory and to where you can recognize, you know, if you see, for instance, in the aldehyde, you see an R, C double bond OH, that is an aldehyde. And specifically, that's called a carbonyl group. But what you can glean from this is, you know, remembering, coming back to general chemistry when we talked about, you know, molecular properties, electronegativity, you know, you say, well, that's a pretty polar group with that C double bond O. There's a lot of electronegativity around that oxygen, which is going to give it a partial negative charge, which then will allow it to, you know, interact with atoms that have, you know, partially positive charges. Even more, if we go down to the carboxylic acid, we can actually get a formal negative charge if we deprotonate that hydroxyl group, and then we can see even more interactions with neighboring positively charged groups, or say the amino group that's the four covalently bounded nitrogen. So again, that's the important thing to keep in your mind. If you can look at a structure, if you can do the Lewis dot structure, that's even better, because you can see where the electrons are. But if you can look at the structure of a functional group and you can get an idea of how the electronegativity properties of it are going to interact with other maybe electropositive property functional groups, then you can get an idea of how these two will interact and come together within a three-dimensional space. You can also get an idea of how things will bind together. You can see, like in the disulfide, you can have disulfide linkages. And also in the diphosphate ester, you can get phosphodiester linkages as well. And we'll get into that here in this next slide. Now here we're just talking about more common functional groups and linkages found in biochemistry. So these are probably pretty much the ones you really want to think about and maybe, you know, commit to memory. However, back here, you know, we talk about phosphate diesters. Those do play a big role in nucleic acids with the sugar phosphate backbone, as well as in adenosine triphosphate, ATP, which is sort of the cell's source of energy. So I would look at the phosphate diesters and phosphate ester functional groups as well, and try to, you know, understand the electronegative properties of those. Like I said, hopefully for most of y'all, this is just a review, and you will get some practice with this in your homework as well, just to where you can recognize what the groups are and what their names are. So here's what I was talking about, where, you know, these functional groups can come together to form linkages. To where you're bridging, say, in a biopolymer, such as protein or DNA, these are normally the compounds that you find linking the monomers, say, an amino acid in a protein or a nucleic acid in a DNA together in order to form the biopolymer. So, again, you know, the major biological polymers in the cell is protein, which is just a polypeptide or is made up of amino acids. So small proteins are called polypeptides. Usually you call something a polypeptide if it's about 10 amino acids or smaller. Nucleic acids are polymers of nucleotides. And normally, you know, small nucleic acids are polynucleotides. And then you can also have polysaccharides or complex carbohydrates, which are polymers of monosaccharides, right? So you can have glucose, fructose, glucogen. We'll talk about those when we talk more about polysaccharides in the future. So a lot of these times, the intramolecular complementary and replication is driven by these functional group interactions between two polymers, such as, let's say, in DNA. So you get two strands of DNA that are complementary to each other, right? So you have the base pairing between adenine and thymine, guanine and cytosine, and because of their functional groups coming off of those nucleotide bases, you get that complementary interaction. And because of that, the complementary interaction between the base pairing functional groups through that hydrogen bonding interaction, you can drive the ability of the cell to be able to self-replicate those DNAs. Without that, you wouldn't have life, because the cell has to be able to replicate itself with the materials that it has on hand. And really it is, if you get down to the chemistry of it, it is these functional groups that help drive that interaction. So, in summing up what this first part of, the functional group, this first section of the chapter, there are checkpoints written into this presentation where you can kind of pause here, you know, read over this, and then ask yourself, all right, do I know how to answer these questions or do these explanations? So, you know, feel free to pause here, go back to your textbook, read over these questions, and just, you know, verify and make sure that you can answer these questions. So I'll give you a moment to hit pause, and then we will get started again. So welcome back. In the second part of this lecture, we're talking about cellular architecture. So what's the difference between prokaryotes and eukaryotes, and, you know, the different components of those cells. And this should hopefully be a review for everybody. At least you had it in high school if you haven't had it in biology yet here at Birmingham Southern. But so we can look at prokaryotes first. So prokaryotes are very simple cells. They're usually unicellular organisms. So it's an organism that's just made up of one cell. And we tend to think, because prokaryotes are non-compartmentalized, meaning they don't have like a nucleus where the DNA is, they don't have the endosomes, which is where proteins are synthesized, they do not have those membrane-bound organelles, so we tend to think that, well, they're simplistic. But if we look at this cross-section here, we can actually see that E. coli, it looks pretty complicated. I mean, there's a lot going on there. And I think that's the take-home message for this. Just because there isn't compartmentalization of organelles doesn't necessarily mean that this is a simple cell. It's just that everything is in one area, but it's all kind of mixed together. But there is still form and function, and there is still a lot going on. Here we can see a number of different prokaryotic cells, and we can see that they range in a number of different sizes and shapes, which is sort of the cool thing about prokaryotes. And then, you know, they can have typical properties based on the cell shapes and the cell sizes. However, because, you know, we're talking about mostly in terms of eukaryotic cells, let's take a look at your typical animal cell, or the cell of a eukaryote. As you can see here, you have compartmentalization of organelles, where you have items such as the Golgi apparatus, the rough ER, you have the nuclear membrane that contains the nucleus, that has DNA and chromatin in it. You can have ribosomal-bound ER, as well as the outer cell membrane, which is the plasma membrane, and lysosomes. So I can go through the function of all of these organelles, however you can find it in your textbook, and I'm sure most of y'all remember. You know, for instance, the mitochondrion is where aerobic respiration occurs. It's where ATP is derived through the electron transport train. Interestingly, we believe that mitochondrion was actually prokaryotic cells that lived in the eukaryote that through evolution has now become an organelle as opposed to its own bacterial cell. And we believe that because the mitochondrion actually has its own DNA. And interestingly, this DNA during reproduction, the DNA in your cells, in the mitochondrion of your cells, is only passed on from your mother. So it's from mother to child. And that's just sort of interesting in and of itself. So we know that that DNA isn't getting recombinated during reproduction. It's its own thing. Let's see, what else? The endoplasmic reticulum, so does your transport system for proteins. The ribosomes, which are bound to the rough endoplasmic reticulum, is actually where protein is synthesized, where messenger RNA is brought to the ribosome and is translated into a protein by binding or by giving a template for which amino acids can come in and bind and then be polymerized to each other as the growing protein is produced. The nucleus is where the chromatin or your DNA or your chromosomes reside. And where replication and transcription occur. So again, go back to your text. You know, read over that. Again, your homework, you'll get some practice with labeling these organelles and telling us where, what functions they provide. And, you know, as we talk more about each specific biopolymer, such as DNA or protein, we'll pull in these organelles and talk about them in more detail. Also, when we talk about the different metabolic reactions that occur, such as glycolysis, you know, we'll talk more about things like the mitochondrion or the lysosome at that point. Here we see our phylogenetic relationship between bacteria, archaea, and eukarya. This is just to see. I mean, we don't. I'm probably not going to test you on this. So that sort of sums up the cellular architecture review. Basically, the things to make sure that you understand are the differences between prokaryotes and eukaryotes, and make sure you know what the organelles are and what function they play in eukaryotic cells. So again, we can pause here, read over these checkpoint questions, and make sure you can answer them. Continuing on, our next section of this chapter discusses thermodynamics, and this is where I really wanted to spend more of the time. This is what may not be as much of a review for you guys, and you know, to me, thermodynamics is the driving force of everything that occurs in the cell, so it's a good foundation for us to start on. Here, Voet put in some key concepts. I'll give you a second if you want to pause and read over them. Just things to think about while we go through this material. It's sort of like the chapter learning objectives, but these are objectives that Voet came up with. So again, I'll give you a second to pause. All right, and we're going to continue on. So thermodynamics, or the laws of thermodynamics, describes how energy can be transferred from one thing to another. And when we talk about energy, we can talk about the energy of a reaction, we can talk about the energy of a system, or the surroundings, or the universe, but in all of them, you know, we have these laws. So the energy of the universe can neither be created nor destroyed. It can only change forms. So what that means is, you know, the energy from the sun is not being created. It was, you know, the energy from the sun comes in into our system, plants take it in and transform it into plant energy or cellulose, and then, say, an herbivore can come and eat that plant, and that cellulose plant energy is converted into animal energy or glycogen, which then that animal may die naturally, and then that as the animal's body is degraded, it's that energy is produced back into the soil, which can then be taken up by the plant roots again. Or, you know, as the body decomposes, sometimes heat is released, which then, you know, that heat energy is released out into the atmosphere, which then will change into different forms in the atmosphere. Or say a predator eats that herbivore animal, and then the energy stored in the herbivore cells is then transferred into the cells of the meat eater or the omnivore. Again, so the energy is then converted from the prey into the predator, and then the predator may die, and then the body decomposes, and all those nutrients and energy is released into the soil or into the atmosphere as heat. So when we talk about the first law of energy, you know, we'll get into this, but we're talking about enthalpy. If we make some assumptions and say that the pressure is constant, which in most living, when we're talking about biochemistry, you know, we do know that the pressure is constant because we are under atmospheric pressure on Earth. So, but when we say that, we can then relate the energy to delta H, which is up here. We can see delta G, which is the Gibbs free energy, is equal to delta H, which is described by the first law of thermodynamics, minus T delta S. So what's delta S? So delta S is sort of our second law of thermodynamics. It is the entropy of an isolated system, not in equilibrium, will tend to increase over time, approaching to a maximum value at equilibrium. So what this says is that the universe is always heading toward chaos, right? So the more entropy, the happier we are. And so by taking these two laws together, just laws one and two, as you can see in the equation at the top, we can determine if a reaction is going to be spontaneous or non-spontaneous. So delta G, or being the change in free energy, is equal to delta H, enthalpy, minus T delta S, entropy. So in order for a reaction to be spontaneous, we want a negative delta G, right? We're always wanting to have lower free energy. We want the lowest energy state possible for the reaction to occur. So in order for us to get a negative delta G, if you look at that equation, we need a negative delta H. So a release of energy is heat, making it exothermic. Do you remember these terms? We can talk about endothermic and exothermic. And negative T delta S, you would want a positive delta S. So you want more entropy or more chaos to give us a more negative delta G in this equation. There's also a third law, which is as temperature approaches absolute zero, the entropy of the system approaches a constant minimum. Really don't need to worry about that one that much, because in any of our cases that we're talking about in biochemistry, we're talking about reactions that occur in the cell or living organism, and we're never going to get to absolute zero under those conditions. Most all the time we're talking about either room temperature or body temperature, which is 37 degrees C or 25 degrees C for room temperature. So, and just taking into consideration those first two laws, let's talk about enthalpy. So the enthalpy measures the amount of energy released or absorbed during a reaction. So we can see in this first reaction coordinate here, the reactants are at a lower energy level than the products. So what this describes is an endothermic or an unfavorable reaction, and where we require energy in order for the reaction to occur overall. Now, this is different from EA, which is the activation energy. Oftentimes that's going to be high, but we have enzymes or other catalysts in the body that can lower that activation energy in order to propel the reaction to occur faster. However, the overall, if we compare reactants to products, we see that the reaction overall is endothermic and thus unfavorable. If we look at the next reaction coordinate diagram, we see that the reactants are higher in energy than the products. So here we have a favorable reaction or exothermic, and that our delta H is negative overall, meaning that this reaction is more likely to occur spontaneously. However, remember, when we're talking about the free energy change, we can't ignore entropy. So here we look at, you know, A and B. If we open our stopcock and allow the molecules to go into the next round bottom flask, we see that we can actually increase the entropy because the molecules can spread out further and can move around and are less constrained in space. Thus, entropy is increasing. Another example of favorable entropy is when you can take two or one molecule, say a polymer, and you can hydrolyze that into two molecules. So thus you have a higher number of molecules in the system, thus there's more chaos, thus you have increased your entropy. However, in biochemistry, when we're talking about a reaction, or we're talking about entropy and enthalpy, we have to consider the whole system and not just, you know, molecule A that breaks up into molecule B and C. It's not that simple. A lot of reactions that are still spontaneous are where A and B come together to form C. And what happens here is if we look at two biopolymers, say two proteins, that come together to bind to form one macromolecule or a complex. If you think about your protein in three-dimensional space, the protein is surrounded by water molecules, both of them. So protein A and protein B are both surrounded by water molecules. And when they come together, the interface of that interaction between A and B, the waters that were there actually get released. So these are structured waters that were sort of bound to both of those proteins are now released. So really, instead of A plus B yields C, what you really have is A plus B yields C plus 20 water molecules. So instead of 1 plus 1 or two molecules becoming one molecule, you actually have two molecules becoming one molecule plus 20 molecules of water. So really that's 21 molecules being released into the system. So actually that would be entropically favorable if we look at it that way. And I can discuss this more in class. It's easier if I draw it out for you guys in order to understand it. So but just keep that in mind whenever we're talking about entropy in biological systems. It's not ever really as simple as just, you know, the two molecules forming one or one molecule forming two. Sometimes it may actually be unfavorable for the one molecule to form two, because now you have to solvate both of those molecules by water. So when we're talking about spontaneity again, you know, we're talking about enthalpy and entropy. So to have a negative delta G, or a lower change, or a negative change in the free energy, a lot of this time delta G is called Gibbs free energy. So remember, you always want to decrease in Gibbs free energy. So in order to have a very spontaneous or exergonic reaction, meaning energy is released, again, you need a negative delta H and a positive delta S. So you want an exothermic reaction that is entropically favorable, and that will give you definitely an exergonic reaction. If you are, if you have a negative enthalpy, so you're exothermic, however, entropy is also negative. It is only spontaneous at temperatures where T is equal, or temperatures below, where T is equal to delta H divided by delta S. You can do the math in order to figure that out. So have delta G is equal to delta H minus T delta S, set delta G to zero, and then solve for T, and you'll see what we mean. So if you have a positive delta H and a positive delta S, so it's endothermic, meaning it's requiring energy in order to drive the reaction. However, it's still entropically favored. It will be spontaneous However, in this instance, when the temperature is higher than delta H divided by delta S. Alright, now if you have an endothermic reaction that is entropically unfavorable, then you definitely will have a non-spontaneous or endergonic reaction at all temperatures. So this means that this reaction is very unlikely to occur at any temperature or is unlikely to occur at any temperature and will now then be non-spontaneous. So kind of what I would do here is, you know, maybe plug in some numbers and just practice this equation a little bit and see if you can see that pattern where it doesn't matter if how negative delta H is or how positive delta S is, it will always be spontaneous. You'll always have a negative delta G. And then play around with the in-between, so negative delta H and negative delta S or positive for both, and you'll see those relationships. Now, we can also relate equilibrium to the change in Gibbs free energy. So let's take our reaction, A plus B yields C plus D. We can relate Gibbs free energy, so the change in the Gibbs free energy of the reaction is equal to the standard Gibbs free energy plus RTLN of the reactant quotient, as you can see here, where you have the products over reactant. So, but if you remember from Gen Chem and maybe some organic, that LN right there is where you have the products over the reactants is also your equilibrium constant. So at equilibrium, delta G is zero. And you can rearrange your equation to now solve for your standard Gibbs free energy, which is the delta G naught is equal to RT ln of KEQ. So we often use these parameters in order to solve for things like delta G. So if we can figure out our equilibrium constant at different temperatures and plot that, we can determine some interesting things. So those are called Van Hoff plots. So here, as you can see, if you plot the ln of KEQ at various temperatures, you can derive your change in enthalpy as well as your change in entropy, as in see these plots here. So again, you know, how do we, you know, in the lab, how would we measure this? So let's say we had a reaction that one of the products has a color to it. We can monitor that reaction, or we can get the concentration of that product at different temperatures, and then we can use those concentrations to determine our KEQ. We can then plot the ln of KEQ on our y-axis. So here we're fitting this equation to y equals mx, and I'll go over this in class with you as well to show you this derivation. But if you have ln of KEQ is your y-axis and 1 over t is your x-axis, you'll see that m, your slope, is going to be negative delta h over r, and your y-intercept is going to be, y equals mx plus b, so b, your intercept, is going to be delta S over R. So by plotting the ln of K versus the 1 over T, we can easily determine exothermic reactions versus endothermic reactions by the slope of the line, which is going to be equal to negative delta H over R. And then we can extrapolate that line down to our interception in order to get delta S over R. So R is being that gas constant, which is the 8.134. We can look that up in the table as well. But this just gives us a good way in the lab. We can, you know, if, like I said, if the molecules that we're analyzing in our equilibrium absorb light at a specific wavelength, we can monitor that absorbance at different temperatures in order to get the different equilibrium constants. Or we can even measure enthalpy directly using calorimetry. We can get into that when we talk about the biochemical techniques later on. So just kind of keep this in mind, though, these Van Hoff plots and how we can derive the enthalpy and entropy. And once we know the enthalpy and entropy, remember we can go back and plug into our equation, you know, delta G equals delta H minus T delta S in order to get our delta G. Or we could also derive delta G from the KEQ. Once we know the equilibrium constant at a certain temperature, we can then solve for delta G as well. And this allows us to predict whether or not reactions are spontaneous. So when we're talking about thermodynamics, you know, we always talk about different systems. So traditionally, thermodynamics deal with closed systems or isolated systems. So an isolated system is a system in which energy or matter are not exchanged at all. A closed system is where matter is not exchanged with the surroundings. However, energy can. So if you think about, you know, in your coffee cup calorimeter, where you can feel the heat coming off of something, but the matter is not exchanged. A good example of isolated would be like your thermos, right? So it keeps the heat in as much as it can. And it also keeps your coffee in. But as soon as you open the top of the thermos and you drink some of that coffee, now we've gone from an isolated system into a open system. So an open system is where energy and matter can flow. So here in this picture, you know, you have radiant energy from the sun coming in, being absorbed by the plants. Through photosynthesis, you can create carbohydrates. Animals will come eat the plants, which then converts the carbohydrates into energy that the animal can use, and then also heat can be lost, you know, through the process of, you know, exerting yourself or just heat being bounced off of the ground from the sun, or our bodies decomposing will give off heat, fire, so on and so forth. So when we're talking about biological systems, you know, keep that in mind that these are open systems. So you have transfer of energy either as heat or as matter. Now we also need to discuss a big difference and I'm turning to that part in the textbook because I'm going to make sure I get this right for you guys. And we'll talk about it in class a little bit too. But you know, when we're talking about open systems, now we also need to talk about something called the steady state. So a lot of students have a hard time and they confuse steady state as the same thing as equilibrium. And that's not right, because an open system is always trying to get to equilibrium, but it may never get to equilibrium because you have exchange of matter and energy. So the book describes it as living systems are characterized by being in a steady state, meaning that all flows in the system are constant so that the system doesn't change with time. Energy flow in the biosphere is an example of a system in a steady state. So you can have slight perturbations from the steady state that give rise to changes in the flows that restore the system to the steady state. So in all living systems, energy flow is exclusively downhill. In addition, nature is inherently dissipative. So the recovery of free energy from a biochemical process is never total, and some energy is always lost. As you can see here in this cycle, you always get some loss of the energy as heat loss. Without getting cheesy and talking about the Lion King and the circle of life, but I mean, it's basically what it is. So you're never really at equilibrium in an open state or a biological system, but you can be at a steady state, meaning that you're constantly, like us as humans, we're constantly taking in food. However, because we cannot completely convert all of that food energy into energy that our bodies can use, it's always some of it is lost. We have to keep taking it in. If we were able to reach equilibrium in our bodies, we could eventually stop eating. But because we can't, we have to continually keep eating, and because we don't reach equilibrium, because we're always continuously decomposing as we age and our cells are dying and we get older, eventually, you know, us too will die. It's also so part of the process when you're thinking about steady state versus equilibrium. So in the back of your mind, sit back and reflect. Read the textbook and understand what are the differences between steady state and equilibrium, and try to come up with a little summary. I mean, this could be a good thing we could discuss on the Facebook page as well, as we can start reflecting on the differences between the two. A lot of our reactions in our body are actually non-spontaneous, and we have to utilize enzymes in that instance in order to overcome those activation energies, in order to drive these metabolic reactions further. Like, and you'll see that in glycolysis, the citric acid cycle, the electron transport chain, all of that. You'll see where enzymes come in to help push these reactions forward, because they are non-spontaneous, and they go against the grain, so to speak. And it is at these, a lot of these reactions that occur, in which we can actually find ways to control these systems. So by inhibiting the enzyme at this key step in the metabolic reaction, we can then cause deleterious effects or diseases, or we can stop something unfavorably. So, you know, read over that section as well. I'm talking about the enzymes catalyzing biological reactions, and kind of think about that as our body is using these enzymes in order to drive the continuation of the steady state cycle in open systems. Let's see. So, you know, here we have the checkpoint for the thermodynamics that the textbook has developed. Again, you know, read over these, see if you can answer them. Thank you for bearing with me in this first lecture. I'm sure they will get better as we continue on, and I can figure out how to interact with the slides so that y'all can see what I'm pointing at. And in the meantime, remember, this is just sort of our review chapter. Do the practice problems on the sapling homework. We'll come in Friday. On Friday, we're going to do our little Jeopardy review game. And basically, if you can answer the objectives on the first slide that I showed you, then that will, you know, be able to demonstrate your understanding of the material, and you'll be okay for the test. But feel free to ask me any questions, post on the Facebook. I really was just sort of summarizing the important key parts of this chapter and what I think y'all should focus on in this chapter. And we will talk more one-on-one in class about things that were unclear or that you think I need to go into more detail on. So, all right. Well, thank you, and y'all have a good day. Bye.